on the Union side.
Whose side are you on, my people? Whose side are you on?
I'm on the Union side.
All right.
It takes a lot of people to move packages through Amazon, and workers at an Amazon warehouse in Alabama have voted on whether to form the company's first union. Nearly 6,000 people work at the fulfillment center in Bessemer, southwest of Birmingham, were awaiting results of the organizing vote from the National Labor Relations Board. Amazon is pushing back on this effort. Many employees say that they don't feel valued and that the $15 an hour they earn is too little for their working conditions. Supporters of unionizing hope for more leverage to improve that. Yes, this kind of work takes a lot of people today, but their jobs could face a bigger threat than Amazon. Technology in general, and that technology is advancing fast. Companies will soon be able to use autonomous robots to increase productivity and lower labor costs. No sick days, no paychecks, 16-hour workdays, and far fewer people on the floor, just enough to operate and repair the machinery. Meet Stretch. It's built to do a lot more than just dance. Its creator, Boston Dynamics, introduced Stretch to the world last year. Stretch can lift boxes, unload trucks, and build pallets. The base model starts at just $70,000. Not that much when you consider what companies pay for a year of one worker's labor and benefits and insurance. Now, it's unclear whether Amazon is planning to buy robots like Stretch, but this is not the only industry moving closer to robotics. Lyft, the nation's second largest ride service company, has been working on self-driving cars. At a certain point, those cars could replace much of the app's fleet, if not all of it. And check out what one of our producers saw at her local grocery store today. This is Marty, isn't he cute? Marty's job is to speak up if there's a cleanup on aisle 5 or some other hazard on the floor. Immigration gets the blame for upending America's job market, but in some industries, automation has a much larger effect. How do we get workers ready for these changes? Are the robots coming for all our jobs? Or will some things always need a human touch? NBC technology correspondent Jake Ward is in Bessemer, Alabama, just outside Birmingham. He's been following the vote and speaking with some of the workers there and joins us now. Jake, how much is the prospect of automation factoring into what the workers want, or perhaps into some of their rationale for organizing?
Well, Joshua, I mean, everything you just said there, you know, really makes the hair on the back of my neck stand up, because it is so extraordinary to be in a place where we are really witnessing, you know, the history of labor clashing with the future of technology in this way. I mean, one thing I will say from speaking to workers here, whether they are for or against the union, and it's a pretty even split in terms of the people we've spoken to, you know, they talk a lot in terms that you and I would think of as being automation style terms. I mean, one of the big terms they say is time on task. They talk about how Amazon is an environment, the warehouse is an environment where you are constantly assessed by whether you are on task. And they talk about whether you are on rate as a delivery driver, whether you can get out of the car and get a package onto the front door of someone's house within 30 seconds, which is the time that's typically budgeted you. So if you think about these quantified ways that people are being evaluated by this company, you know, they can see the writing on the wall. All the people that we spoke to recognize that robots are coming, they'll be part of this in the future. And that's why, in part, I think there's some reluctance about getting a union going, because they worry it will take too long to get a new contract. And by that time, who knows what technology may be on the floor. And yet at the same time, there is the feeling that, you know, the tide is coming. And so maybe they do need to organize. These are the two sides of it that we're hearing.
I don't think there's anybody in Silicon Valley who has ever presumed that companies like Lyft, Uber, Amazon would balk necessarily at approaching this new technology simply out of the goodness of their hearts. I just don't think anybody saw these companies from their start kind of an enterprise. And it doesn't mean that they're mean, but that's the way that forward-looking, like, you know, bleeding-edge technology companies are designed to operate. What about the future of these kinds of jobs? I mean, Boston Dynamics, their argument is that, well, some jobs will go away, but it will create other jobs. So it doesn't mean that everyone is going to get bulldozed by automation.
Mm-hmm. That's right. I think there's something very interesting that you raised there, right? There is this philosophical mindset that one can automate these jobs, you know, and there's really no job that can't be automated, really, is what we're learning here from technology. And yet, philosophically, it feels as if a refrain I hear a lot as a technology reporter is, these are extremely difficult jobs, and that's why, or tedious jobs, or whatever it is, and that's why you would want to automate them. You know, people don't necessarily want these jobs, is what I hear a lot of the people who make the technology end up saying. Now, to this question of, you know, what jobs are safe, I mean, I don't know that there's any job that's safe. I'm working on a book right now about the sort of the broad effect of technology on human behavior. You can't find an area of human activity that can't be automated in some way. You know, I was just talking the other day to a company in Korea that's talking about automating the process of drawing comics, such that if you and I, Joshua, don't know how to draw a comic, we could just put in what we want and a piece of AI will do it for you. I mean, there's very little, I think, that a technology company isn't working on. Now, the ones that really, you know, stack high are, of course, things like unpredictable labor, right? Hiring somebody to mow your lawn, that could be, you know, that could disappear within, you know, just a few years. I mean, one big estimate from McKinsey says that between 300 million to 800 million jobs in the world will simply disappear. And that, you know, and here's the real problem, only about 75 million to 375 million, sorry, basically half of those jobs will require a total reskilling of the people who used to do them. So that means that those people who've lost that job don't have the skills they need to move into a new job. So if you're looking at a world where comic books are being drawn by robots and you got to totally reinvent yourself professionally, it's not clear really that anyone is holding back anything. We could be going, who knows where we're headed in terms of how society is even going to be structured in that kind of world.
Well, see, and that's kind of what I wonder about, Jake, because these jobs that require reskilling, there have been a number of parts of the country that have begun creating new academies, community college programs to try to teach people how to do these jobs. I remember in my last gig, we did a show called How to Make Six Figures Without a College Degree. And it was all about these new jobs in this new economy that people who have gigs like the work at this Amazon warehouse can learn because they already have some technical skill, even if it's not a four-year degree. What's your sense of where that stands in terms of helping people get ahead of this change and be part of it?
Well, you know, we have reported extensively on the very deep systematic inequality in certainly the United States, certainly in other countries, between people at the very top of those industries with a four-year degree who can get in there and make an extraordinary living, and people who, for instance, don't have a four-year degree. I mean, for instance, if you slap a four-year degree requirement on a job right now, you're wiping out huge amounts of underrepresented communities, right? But let's take as an argument that we could somehow work all of that out. The extraordinary diversity problem in tech gets sorted out, that you know, we truly bring people in an equitable way with the right training for the right jobs. There are still, I mean, the estimate is still that something like artificial intelligence, right, which could automate huge swaths of human life, you know, could wipe out sort of human labor and to such a degree that the CEO of OpenAI, which is one of the biggest AI research facilities in the world, he just wrote the other day a big piece basically saying that he thinks that AI can generate enough wealth to pay Americans about $13,500 a year as some sort of, I don't know if that's an alternative to work or what it would be. Now, economists take a lot of issue with what he's saying, but what he's essentially saying is even if we had a perfect system, right, it's still going to be the case that we're going to basically overflow the bounds of accepted capitalism, and we're going to need to somehow figure out a way to revalue how people get paid for just being human. Because I think what we're bumping into is a world in which people are going to no longer be evaluated on whether they are productive, because machines are going to be more productive than people. So if we get to that place, what are we doing, right? I mean, what does the economy even end up looking like?
Before I let you go, Jake, I was going to ask, what do you think is the best way for people to get ahead of that? I've heard that some people say that it's those soft skills, it's perceptive skills, creative skills, human skills, all the things that we're told are soft skills that are the ones that are going to be the hardest to teach machines to emulate the way that human beings do naturally. Where do we stand in terms of fighting back against the machines before we go?
Yeah, I hope that that is true. I will say the book that I'm writing suggests to me that there are a lot of those soft skills that automation is going to get involved in. I mean, you already have systems that are trying to guide us in how to speak professionally to one another. Literally, a coach that talks in your ear as you're speaking to somebody or texting with somebody. So I'm not sure there's any part of life that isn't going to get touched by automation. But I do think there is the possibility to cultivate soft skills, and especially if these companies can get better at doing things like waiving a four-year degree requirement, really just looking at those soft skills in the hiring rather than all of this, you know, maybe there's a future for all of us, Joshua.
I certainly hope so, because I just got to NBC and I like it here. So I would like to be able to stay a little bit longer before our robot overlords kick me out of
you
this chair.
Both.
Exactly. Fingers crossed. Thank you,
That's
Jake.
Right.
That's NBC Tech correspondent Jake Ward reporting from Bessemer, Alabama.